cross as you wait for the crown. Tell the world of the treasures you found.
Amen. You may be seated, but maybe this morning you feel like that, that you need God's arms open wide and you need to run into his arms this morning. Maybe you've it's been quite a situation in your week and you just need that image of running into Jesus' arms. So let's just bow our heads for just a moment of silent prayer and give him that situation. Give him that name. And then just, you're running into his arms. He's holding you. Heavenly Father, we thank you for that imagery in the Bible of your outstretched arms. That imagery in the Bible of you setting and picking the children up into your lap. And that we need to be children, just like the little children. So we need to be held by you in your lap. And Lord Jesus, I pray for anyone here this morning who's walked through a pretty rough week. Some things were thrown at you that you didn't expect. They didn't expect it. But Lord, to know that you're a loving Father. And you saw it ahead of the time. And that we wouldn't run away from you at this time, but we would run to you. That we wouldn't isolate ourselves, but rather we'd get around the body of Christ and seek the comfort and the direction and the guidance that you've put within our reach, Lord. So, Lord, help us to be wise in following after you. Lord, thank you for this morning and our time to be in your house. In thy precious name, amen. Amen. Children are dismissed to children's church. While they are going, I'm going to send something around. This is for the harvest dinner. If you haven't signed up or you've missed this, feel free to put your name down. Or also check it. If you've said, I'm going to bring something, mark that in there. So we're just going to send this off. We're going to start it here and it can go around. And so when you see it, you'll see what it is. Great morning this morning. If you have your Bibles, we are turning to Luke chapter 4. Luke chapter 4, starting at verse 38. Luke 4, 38. At first, I just want you to hear the word of the Lord. I'm just going to read it to you. It goes through the end of the chapter. We'll finish up this chapter of the book of Luke this morning. Luke chapter 4, verse 38 to 44. Listen to God's word. It says, after he left the synagogue, he entered Simon's house. And Simon's mother-in-law was suffering from a high fever, and they asked him about her. And so he stood over her and rebuked the fever, and it left her. And she got up immediately and began to serve them. And when the sun was setting, all those who had anyone sick with various diseases brought them to him. And as he laid his hands on each one of them, he healed them. And also demons were coming out of many, shouting and saying, "You are the Son of God." But he rebuked them and would not allow them to speak because they knew he was the Christ. And when it was day, he went out and made his way to a deserted place. But the crowds were searching for him. They came to him and tried to keep him from leaving them. But he said to them, "It is necessary for me to proclaim the good news about the kingdom of God to the other towns also, because I was sent for this purpose." And he was preaching in the synagogues of Judea. Heavenly Father, thank you for this passage of Scripture, and help us, Lord, with the assistance of your Holy Spirit to understand, to apply, and Lord, just enrich this time that we have with your word this morning. In thy precious name, amen. I've titled this sermon, Body, Mind, and the Soul. Body, Mind, and the Soul. And or another alternative is natural, supernatural, and the eternal. And I hope to cover all three of those parts this morning. But I want to remind us of, first off, of the gospel. Here's a reminder of the gospel. What is the gospel? Well, first off, we are all sinners in need of a Savior. We are all sinners in need of a Savior. The second one is that because of that, God came into the world. That was the plan. God came into the world. How did he come into the world? He was born of a virgin. That's the prophecy, along with many other prophecies that were given about him. And then he lived a sinless life. A sinless life. He was the perfect atonement for our sin. And he died as a substitute for believing sinners, for those who call on the name of the Lord, those who live after him. And then he rose from the dead on the third day, just like he said he would. And then he conquered death for all who believe. And then the last point, he's coming again. That is the gospel. That is what we preach about this Jesus. Now, let's go another slide here about physical proof. The Bible gives us physical proof. As we've been going through the Gospel of Luke, Luke has been using many different ways to show us that Jesus is the Messiah. And now he's to the point in the Gospel to say, I'm going to give you some physical proof. I'm going to give you some things to hold on to that you're going to see, that you're going to read, that you can hold on to. Well, the Bible does that as a whole. Not just this one section of Scripture, but as a whole. How does the Bible do that? It does it by geography. The Bible gives us plenty of places that we can look up on a map, even places that have been buried by dirt. Archaeologists can come in and dig it away and find out, oh, here's a city underneath here, and the city has the name of such and such, and lo and behold, you can open up your Bible, and there is that city's name that's been recorded. So it gives us physical proof of geology. You have to click it one more time there. Yeah. Geographic. And then the next one is personalities. The Bible gives us plenty of personalities, plenty of names. Names of people in history that, again, you can go back to. You can go to extra biblical sightings, and it gives those names that are there. The third one there is events. The Bible gives us plenty of events. Events of historical nature that are there that are verified by other sources, but they many times the first place that you come across them is in the Bible. Another physical proof is time and place. The Bible does not leave this off at all. Lots of times it will give you the time, it will give you the place. It's almost like it's baiting you to check this out, to see if this really is so. And it will give you all that information about it. And then the last one, even conversations. The Bible gives us conversations. So lots of times we'll talk about the Bible being a history book. But it's, for me, it's more than that. The Bible is not only history, but it's evidence. It's evidence that God is here. And God is who he says he is, and Jesus is who he says he is. Well, Luke is going to give us some physical proof this morning. And here's three areas. The first off is the body. The body. When we are born, we are born to die. As soon as you're born, you're headed toward the grave. At some point in time, that's what's going to happen to you. But the question is, does the Messiah have power over physical problems? We're going to see that in this passage of Scripture this morning. Does the Messiah have power over physical problems? Does Jesus deal with the natural world? I'm hoping that we see that this morning in this passage. The second one is the mind. Is the mind, and the mind is the will that directs. The mind, it decides which way we're going to go. The mind is influenced by outside sources of which way you're going to go. So does the Messiah have power over temptations, lusts, and evil desires? Does he have power over that? Does Jesus deal with the supernatural world that is beyond us? Can he deal with what feeds our minds and influences us on the direction that we go? That's the second one. The third one is the soul. The soul, the eternal part of our lives. Now, does the Messiah have power to transfer people from the eternal kingdom of damnation to the eternal kingdom of righteousness? Does he have that kind of power? So does Jesus deal with the eternal destiny of mankind? So I'm hoping as we walk through this passage that you're going to see all three of those. You're going to see Jesus' power portrayed in every aspect that I've given you there. Now, when the Jews were waiting for the Messiah, they were praying for the Messiah. Remember, Zechariah was praying for the Messiah. They had some things in their heads of what they wanted the Messiah to be like. So some of them wanted a political deliverer. That's what they wanted, a political deliverer. They wanted someone to come in and fix their government. That's what they wanted. They wanted someone to make sure that we got the right party in heading up the government. Other ones wanted a military Messiah. They wanted a Messiah who would come in and fix the world, that he would have this bully club and he would just thump everybody on the head that wasn't thinking the way he was thinking. There's other ones who wanted a social reformer. That's what they wanted their Messiah to be. They wanted him to fix their poverty or their welfare or their health care, all that kind of stuff. That's what kind of Jesus they wanted. Another one, they wanted an economic guru. An economic guru to come in and fix the economy. You know, no more 2008 kind of thing. And then the last one, they wanted the Messiah to be a rights restorer. Fix our prejudice, Lord. Fix our prejudice. Help us to all get along. I hope I threw enough modern phrases in there that you realize that we still do that today. Sometimes we paint a picture of Jesus that really isn't a picture of Jesus at all. We paint a picture of him in one of these five areas, what we would like to see him do or how he's going to operate or how he's going to run. And this is what our Jesus is like. So we have to ward against that when we go to Scripture, and we have to try to look at Scripture as it says it is. So let's go back to this passage, verse 38. It says, after he, meaning Jesus, left the synagogue, he entered Simon's house, and Simon's mother-in-law was suffering from a high fever, and they asked him about her. Now, I love this passage of Scripture. I've preached on it through Matthew and Mark, and now I get Luke, and it's just like a day in the life of Jesus. That's what you're going to get, because it just goes from one event to the next, to the next, to the next, and if you just walk right along, you're walking with Jesus. You're seeing what he's doing on an average day. This is what happens in Jesus' life, and so I like this a lot, because I'm going to use some illustrations this morning, and I'm going to ask Brian Smith to help me. So Brian, come on up. Come on up, Brian, and Tony, I'm going to ask you to come up here too. Tony, and Tony, you get to sit here down by my wife, though. Brian's got to come up here. Okay, Brian, who you're going to represent all the way through here is Simon, also known as Peter. But Simon is not Peter yet. See, your name hasn't been changed by Jesus yet. You're still Simon. You're actually not even a disciple of his yet. You're not named as a disciple of Jesus yet at this point. Now, most likely, you've probably heard about him. You're a fisherman. You've probably heard of some of the things that were happening, but you're just Simon at this point. And the passage says, in Simon's house. You're born in Bethsaida, in that town, but now you've moved to the town of Capernaum. And Capernaum is on the northern end of the Sea of Galilee. It's a perfect place to be as a fisherman. We know that you have a brother named Andrew. And not only do you have a brother named Andrew, but you have some buddies named James and John. And all of you guys are fishermen. Lots of times you probably team up together to fish together and work together in those situations. That's what you do. And you're married. Well, isn't that great? Yeah, I know. I think so too. You're married. And tradition says, now this is just tradition. Tradition says you have kids. Okay? You have children. Yeah. Some say four girls. No, that's I threw that in there. But just the other day, you were down by the seashore in the morning. You had fished all night. You were there doing the last task of the day of your work day and straightening out your nets, getting them straightened back out for the next night to be able to fish. And while you're there, Jesus comes by. And Jesus says, follow me. And for some reason, you drop everything and follow him, along with your brother and along with James and John. You follow him. Now, maybe you've heard of Jesus. Maybe you heard about him coming to Canaan, and he turned the water into wine at the wedding. Maybe you missed him when he first time he came to Capernaum. You missed him that time. But then you heard he went down to Judea, and he was doing some great things there. And then you heard through the grapevine up the Sea of Galilee, you heard that he was coming north. And maybe you get to see him. He went to Nazareth. Now he's in your hometown. You're out by the seashore, fiddling with your nets, cleaning them up, and here comes Jesus, the one that you hope maybe you'd see. And he said, follow me, and you dropped everything. You not only dropped everything and followed him, but you followed him into the synagogue on that Sabbath day. And you were sitting there with Andrew and James and John. You were all sitting there watching us, and you were enthralled in what Jesus was saying and all these things that were he was talking about. But right in the middle of that sermon of what he was teaching, this guy screams out, ah! And, you know, everybody jumped and everything. And you're like, whoa, man, I haven't been to a synagogue in a while. I don't remember that happening kind of thing. But you were like, whoa. And what you experienced was you saw Jesus drive that demon right out of that man. And everybody else saw it too. Well, at the end of the service, you're pretty brave. You came up to Jesus, the guy who was speaking, and you said, hey, you want to have lunch? Because that's what happened. We think we invented that. No. That goes a long ways back. They would have their Sabbath day, and they would be in the synagogue. And when they got done with the synagogue, then they would head home, and they would have this huge meal. They would have this huge meal. We sometimes go out, but sometimes we go home. We have this, it's usually the biggest meal of the day. So you asked Jesus to come with you. And Mark's gospel tells us that Andrew was with you, and James and John were both with you. So now you didn't just ask Jesus home. You asked Andrew home. You're bringing a bunch home to Jacqueline.
Busy.
Yes, he's going to be busy. Now, here's where the problem comes in, is that when you get home, maybe you forgot about this, but as you opened up the door, you remembered it. Oh, my mother-in-law's here. Ah, but your mother-in-law's not in such good shape. It's Dr. Luke says that she has a high fever. A high fever means what's going on inside of her body. There's some type of infection that's going on inside of her body that the body is trying to fight off. The fact that you have a mother-in-law states that you're married. You got to be married to have a mother-in-law. True. Okay, that's how that works. But for her to be there, there's a couple options. The first one's a terrible option, that her husband is not here anymore. Sorry about that, Wally. And therefore, she's come into your house, and you're to care for her the rest of your life. The other option is that Wally could still be here, but she is so sick that your wife, Jacqueline, is taking care of her. But the way that it's written, she's in pretty bad shape. She's really bad shape. And you come to Jesus. It's interesting. I want to give one more thing, one more verse here. Look at this verse here. Next slide. This is another one, just to show you that Peter was married, okay? 1 Corinthians 9:5, it says, Paul's speaking, don't we have the right to be accompanied by a believing wife? And then he gives three groups, like the other apostles, so there's apostles that have believing wives, the Lord's brothers, the Lord had other brothers, they had wives, and Cephas, guess who Cephas is? That's you. That's another name for Peter, that you not only have a wife, but you have a what wife? A believing wife that's there. Okay, now let's go to the next verse. So he stood over her and rebuked the fever, and it left her, and she got up immediately and began to serve them. So let's go down to Tony. See, you came into the house, and you remembered, oh yeah, my mother-in-law. And she's in bad shape. I was going to have you lay down, but that's okay. You just stay right there. But you basically come up to Jesus and say, Jesus, is there anything you can do? I mean, I've heard about you, and I've saw what you did in the sanctuary. I just saw what you did in the synagogue. But is there anything that you can do for my mother-in-law? And you can Jesus came over her, so most likely she was laying down. came over her, and he rebuked the fever, and it left. Not only did the fever left, but whatever infection was inside of her was driven out of her body. And it says there, oh, I lost the thing. It was that it immediately left her, and where did she go? She began to serve them. Because why? Because you've got four buddies with you, plus Jesus, and possibly two ladies and some kids in the household. I mean, kind of thing. There was no saying to Tony, Tony, just sit there for a while. There's no sending her to the recovery room or anything like that. I mean, she just got right up from that moment and went right into the kitchen to help Jacqueline. And Jacqueline went, wow, just never know what my husband's going to bring home, you know, kind of thing. Now, but this opens us up to this point about healing. Healing was a sign of who Jesus was. Healing was always done so that it would point to Jesus and say, Jesus has this power. Give me the next one there. Click, click. And this is how he did it. As we look at healings in the Bible, he did it either by a word or touch. He didn't have a set formula kind of thing. You weren't boxing him in on how he could do this. The next one is that it was instantaneously. When Jesus healed, it was right now. There was no waiting on it. Even when he healed the man and he saw it as trees walking, but he touched him again, it's instant what was happening. The next thing, it was totally. It was like new. The skin would be just like a baby's skin. Everything was just back to the original order that was there. So it's no surprise that Tony would, boom, just get right up from where she was and go right into the kitchen. She didn't need any recovery time. She didn't need any, rehab. She didn't need any of that. She walked right into that kitchen. Now, one more is that Jesus healed everybody. I mean, everybody that came in contact with him, everybody, even unbelievers. Even unbelievers. Some people didn't even ask to be healed, and he healed them. And the last one, he raised people from the dead. I mean, if that's not enough to show you power, the person that died, are they asking to be raised from the dead? No. Are we basing it off of their faith? Well, no, they're dead. But here, Jesus shows in the most powerful way his physical, his proof that he has power over nature. Over nature. Now, what's great is verse 40. When the sun was setting, and all those who had anyone sick with various diseases brought them to him, and he laid his hands on each one of them, and he healed them. Now here's what happened next, Peter. You saw that? Mom-in-law got up, went to the kitchen, had a good meal. Sunday afternoon. Yeah, a little siesta. I said that for Pastor Emmanuel. A little siesta. And then it's getting towards sundown. And when sundown comes, that's the end of the Sabbath. Sabbath goes from sundown to sundown. It's the end of the Sabbath. When sundown comes, then the Sabbath laws are lifted. On the Sabbath, there were laws of how far you could travel. There were laws on how much you could carry. And so at sundown, those laws were lifted. Now you could travel as far as you wanted to go, and you could carry as much as you wanted to carry. So there were people who waited until the sun went down to follow the law of God, and then there came a knock at your door. And so, okay, let's go down here. And you guys all stand up. And you're the first guy at the door. There's a knock at your door. And this guy shows up, and he looks bad. He looks really bad. And you...
doesn't look so bad to me.
Yeah. You watch, close up, up front, you watch Jesus heal him. And then he sits down, and then the next one comes. And this one's worse than the last one. And you watch Jesus heal him. And he sits down. And then you watch the next one come up. Yeah. You're such a nice host, I tell you. Yeah.
I've been working in the kitchen all day. The least I can do is...
I know. But you watch this happen over and over again. Thanks, guys. You watch it happen over and over again. Every single person that comes up to your door, you and Andrew and James and John are all witnesses of this over and over and over and over. You might be standing there going, well, I don't know about this one. This one looks pretty bad. Or maybe you're looking down the line. Oh, I don't know about that one down there. But everyone that comes up, he touches and he heals. You're a witness of that. Now, why is this important? Because I'm going to tell you, Peter, later on down the road, you're going to watch Jesus get hung on a cross. He's going to rise from the dead. You're going to be witness of the risen Lord. You're going to be filled with the Holy Spirit. On the day of Pentecost, you're going to preach this tremendous message. 3,000 are going to be added to the church that day. But at some point, you and John are going to stand in front of the same court that condemned Jesus to the cross. You're going to stand in front of them. And they're going to ask you to stop talking about the risen Lord. That's what they're going to ask you to do. Stop, Peter, John, just stop talking about this. You're messing with people's minds, and you need to stop talking about this. Now, in your mind, you kind of replay your life. Now, you've stumbled along the way, and you've put your foot in your mouth a couple times, and you've denied him 3 times. And everything else. I mean, but he kept coming back to you, and you kept going back to him. And here's what you say to those guys. Now, this is Adam's version. Are you crazy? are you seriously asking me to stop talking about the risen Lord that I've touched, that I've seen, that I've heard? Are you crazy? Are you crazy to think that I would follow your command rather than the command of the Almighty God? For he is the Christ, the Son of the living God. Are you out of your mind? And when it says in the scripture, when you and John leave, you're rejoicing like crazy. Why? I'm sure that you could think back to, man, remember when he was at my house? Remember the one of the first times I met him? And there was a knock at the door? And there was a whole lineup. Mark's gospel says that the whole town of Capernaum showed up. And I watched over and over and over and over and over and over again Jesus' power over the physical. He's going to take us farther, though, Brian. Peter, come on back up. Next verse. Also, demons were coming out of many, shouting and saying, "You are the Son of God." But he rebuked them, and he would not allow them to speak because they knew he was the Christ. Some points here. Jesus was over the disease and death. That's the body, the natural. Jesus is also over the demons, the mind, the supernatural. And that word for coming out there means he drove them out or they voluntarily came out. So as they're coming up in the line, either they try to speak and he says, go, or they can't even be in the presence of Jesus and they're voluntarily driven out. The word for rebuke there means charge sharply with authority. So he's not saying, it'd be kind of nice if you left. No. I mean, it is all out frontal, Jesus commanding, boom, this is going to happen kind of thing. And then he not allow them to speak. That means he didn't even let them make a sound. So they started. You know, throw it away, kind of thing. That's what Jesus had that power, and you saw that over the supernatural. He saw it in the synagogue.
Yeah, I did.
But now you see it in your home over and over and over and over again. Then the scripture goes on to say, and when it was day, wait a minute, when was it before? It was night. It was sundown. So how long has Jesus been doing this? All through the night. I mean, he pulled on all-nighter is what he did. He did a Peter lock-in at Peter's house. There was a lock-in at Peter's house. He pulled on all-nighter, and then he went out and made his way to a deserted place, but the crowds were searching for him. They came to him and tried to keep him from leaving them. Now, remember back in Nazareth? What did they want to do with Jesus in Nazareth? They wanted to throw him off the cliff, didn't they? And what did Jesus do? He walked right through them. It was like they were trying to do something to Jesus, but he had so much power. It's like, no, you can't touch me. Here, in this situation, now they're trying to hold on to him and say, no, you can't leave. And this is what Jesus says next. And he said to them, it is necessary. Everybody say necessary. Necessary. For me to proclaim the good news about the kingdom of God to the other towns also, because I was sent for this purpose. Say purpose.
Purpose.
Purpose. I was sent for this purpose. So here's our three, Brian. Jesus over the disease and death, that's the body and the natural. Jesus over the demons, the mind, the supernatural. Jesus now over the devil's domain, the soul, the eternal. And I want you to see this, is that Jesus left the healing and the driving out to go do what? Preach the gospel. Now, I'm sure as you're standing there, that watching these healings and these bones and whatever came up to the door, it said various diseases, so it's all kinds of stuff going on, and you're just getting blown away by that. That's pretty impressive. And then you see these demons being driven out by people, and they're being shut up by Jesus, that they don't even have the power to say anything anymore because he has taken it away from that. That's got to be pretty phenomenal kind of thing. But then you watch Jesus walk away from those two kind of really phenomenal things and say, you know what, but something else is necessary. More necessary than the healings, more necessary than the driving out of demons. What's more necessary is that I go to these other towns and tell them about the gospel. That's what's more important. And so verse 44, we end it. And he was preaching in the synagogues of Judea, meaning the whole area, including Galilee to the north. Brian, I want to thank you so much for helping me out this morning. I just have a couple more slides. I want us to see this, where Jesus puts his emphasis. I mean, he does the healings. He does the driving out of demons. Those are all to point to him. But look at where he puts the emphasis. He puts his emphasis on making sure to get to these other towns to tell them the gospel. What is the gospel? It's all the way back to Nazareth when he's speaking out of Isaiah 61, 1 and 2. He says, I've come to offer spiritual riches to those who are spiritually bankrupt. Those of you who know that you're a sinner, I've come to give you grace. I've come to give you a gift to you. And I've come to release or give forgiveness to those who are in spiritual bondage. When you realize that you are a sinner and you have sin and you need forgiveness of that sin, he says, I've come to release you of that, to forgive you of that. And I've come to give you sight to those to know him, to those who are spiritually blind. He says, I'm going to open up your eyes so that you'll be like the thief on the cross and look at me and call me your king, call me your Lord. He says, I've come to open up your eyes to see me as the Messiah. And then the last one, to free the spiritually bound. To free the spiritually bound. He says, that's why I have come. That's what's necessary, and that's my purpose. Now, last slide. Some churches focus on the healings. They kind of hang out there, in which... Do healings still happen today? Yes, they do still happen today, and they should still happen only to point people to Jesus. But there are some times when we can get hung up on that natural, that thing that happens in the natural world, and maybe elevate it a little bit too high. And some churches focus in on the power, the supernatural, the things being driven out, the dramatic things like that. And do those things happen today? Yeah, they still happen today, but they always should be a sign to point to who he is. But both are signs with a purpose to see the one who brings the gospel. Because it's the gospel that deals with the eternal. It's the gospel that takes us from going to hell to going to heaven. That's what it is. And we need to be a church about what is necessary. That's what we need to be. That's what we need to hear from the pulpit. That's what we need to hear in our Sunday school classes. That's what we need to hear in our small groups. That's what we need to hear. What is necessary is the gospel of Jesus Christ. We will walk through the natural world that we live in. And sometimes we will receive healings, and sometimes we won't. Sometimes we will suffer through. He will have us suffer through things for our benefit that's there. But we will walk through the natural world. We will battle with the supernatural. We will. Satan is still at work. He's trying to get you to do things you know you shouldn't do. And he's going to battle over your mind and things like that. We're going to battle with the supernatural because he tells us what? Put on the full armor of what? Of God to do battle against that. But we need to be changed eternally by the gospel. We need to be changed eternally by the gospel. That's what changes us. That's what needs to be necessary. And that's what needs to be our purpose as we gather together as a church. May the gospel ever be preached that Jesus is the Lord of all. He is. Would you stand with me and sing this song? Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. When I feel afraid, think I've lost my way, still you're there right beside me. And nothing will I fear as long as you are near. Please be near me to the end. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. I will not forget your love for me, and yet my heart forever is wandering. Jesus, be my guide and hold me to your side, and I will love you to the end. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Let's bow our heads and pray.